privilege to introduce Dr. Raju Kasambe. So to begin with, Dr. Raju Kasambe, he has worked as a medical representative in a multinational pharmaceutical company named Novartis. You must have heard of this company, and he worked there for 17 years. So what made him change his profession? You all must have seen the movie Three Idiots, right? So that's what made him thinking, this is what I want to do. So he made a call and he took the train and he got himself into BNHS. So it's been 10 years that he's been associated with BNHS. Initially, he worked as a project manager of IBA, that is Important Bird Areas. And currently he's working as assistant director of education in Conservation Education Center of BNHS. So Dr. Raju Kasambe, he has his PhD in hornbills, on breeding biology of Indian grey hornbills, which is why he is one of the best person to take a stroll into the secret lives of hornbills. And he has his MSc dissertations where he has worked on blue-tailed bee eaters as well, and his MPhil on butterflies. And till today, he is author of several, I mean, I cannot even number how many e-books. And his e-books have got downloads of around about 3 lakhs. It's just been a couple of weeks that his recent ebook was published. It is called 100 Common Birds of India. So congratulations, Dr. Raju Kasambe, for that. And he is author and co-author to various and numerous scientific research articles and short notes. So this Dr. Raju Kasambe's resume would take another webinar. So without a further ado, I think we would hand over to Dr. Raju Kasambe. Dr. Raju, over to you.
Thanks, Sagar. Nikhil,
hi, Raju.
Yeah, shall I start?
Yes, please start. We're all here. Please start.
Okay.
Thanks.
I'm sharing my screen.
You can show your face first so people can see you.
I will switch on the video also.
Yeah, thanks. Can I ask everybody else to put their videos off so we have good bandwidth for Raju to show his slides? Thank you, everybody.
So I don't know. Can you see me?
Yes, we can see you. Nice red t-shirt.
Oh. Nice red t-shirt, thanks. So, namaste and good evening to all of you. I can't see myself actually.
It's a famous saying in the jungle where you go see tiger. It's important that tiger sees you, not that you see a tiger.
Just a minute, okay? Just trying to. Sorry. Okay, let it be. So I assume you can see me. Okay, good evening and namaste again. And today I'll be talking about the hornbills in general, but as Sagar mentioned, my interest is Indian grey hornbill because I did my PhD on Indian grey hornbill, and so my perspective of looking at all these species of hornbills is of course from the Indian grey hornbills point of view. And luckily, let me thank Nikhil and Delibird Foundation and all associated organizations like Sanctuary for inviting me to deliver this talk. And on the right side on my screen, you can see an Indian grey hornbill male with an insect prey, and you can see the black skin around its eyes. That is known as suborbital skin. And on the left is the same male Indian grey hornbill in flight. So just to take you around in few slides, and a few minutes. We have 55 species of hornbills in the world, and South and Southeast Asia, we have got all the hornbills which are forest species and which are mostly tree dwelling or arboreal species and mostly frugivorous. Frugivorous means fruit eating, and these are the species which become omnivorous during breeding season, or you can say they eat more of animal diet when they are in the breeding. We have ground hornbills and other tree hornbill species or arboreal species of hornbills in Africa, and these particularly belong to bookworms, and there are 24 species. And these ground hornbills especially are carnivores. So the major diet includes animal diet. So if you look at the distribution of hornbills, you can see that there are no hornbills in northern part of Asia and Europe and Australia, and as well as in the Americas. So, but Indian subcontinent has got 10 species of hornbills, and maximum species will be here, that is Southeast Asia. And out of the 10 species in the Indian subcontinent, we have only one species which is endemic to Sri Lanka. That means there are 9 species which are found in India. And so this is general distribution, just a general distribution of hornbills. So what are the most interesting things about in hornbills? As the name suggests, hornbills have a horn or a cusp which is there on their heads, or you can say on their beaks. And the beaks are also already oversized and very huge. So this is a great pied hornbill or great hornbill, one of the largest hornbills, and this is the Indian grey hornbill. One more thing about hornbills is that they have eyelashes, beautiful eyelashes. Here, this is the Indian grey hornbill, and this is the southern ground hornbill. Now you can see the eyelashes here. Okay, there are a few more facts. So they can see the tip of their own beak. That means they know how to manipulate or play with the food item which they are handling. So they are considered to be monogamous, and only there are studies conducted on only one species, genetically proved that they are 100% fidel to each other and monogamous. Monogamous means in one season at least they remain true to each other. So the most important thing, and why I chose hornbill as the subject of my PhD, is that the female of the hornbill seals herself inside a tree cavity during breeding season. That is the reason why the word secrets come, because once the female seals herself, you don't know what is going on inside the nest. And when the female seals herself inside the tree cavity, she has to rely on her partner for 100% of the provisioning which is required, whatever she needs, whatever her chicks need during all those the days of incarceration or imprisonment, she has to rely on the male who is outside. One more very interesting thing, and an excellent example of convergent evolution, is the toucans. The toucans are found in the Americas, and this is an excellent example of co-evolution or convergent evolution, in the sense they also are very similar to hornbills. Like they have a big, very big sized beak, which looks like the bird will fall down on the head because of the weight of the beak. That is how you feel. And they are frugivorous, and also they nest in tree cavities. So these hornbills as well as toucans adapted to their different environments in the same way. That's how they developed similar traits, and they look very similar, but they are not at all related to each other. Considering the evolution, this is a photograph of a kill-billed toucan, which is one of the most colorful toucans. So the 9 species of hornbills here, instead of putting photographs, I have this Arjun Srivastava's beautiful sketch. So we have got a great hornbill, the greatest or the biggest hornbill species here, and brown hornbill, Indian grey hornbill. Of course, brown is very, very rare. Indian grey hornbill is the commonest and found throughout most parts of India. Then we have Malabar grey hornbill, which is endemic to southern western Ghats, I will say. Then Narkundam hornbill, which is endemic to only one island in India. There is the Narkundam island near to Andamans. Then we have Rith hornbill, the Malabar pied hornbill, and Oriental pied hornbill. Again, looking at the distribution, Oriental pied hornbill has a very vast distribution from India to Southeast Asia. And we have then Rufous necked hornbill, again, one of the biggest hornbills. So we have these 9 species of hornbills in India. The subject of my interest is the Indian grey hornbill. And as most of the hornbills have clearly show sexual dimorphism. Even Indian grey horn will show sexual dimorphism. The male has a slightly bigger cast, is a pointed, has a pointed cast, and the skin around the eye is also black, suborbital skin. Then the beak is only white around as a fringe, whereas the female has an ivory colored beak. The cast is shorter and obtuse or not so pointed, and the skin around the eye here it's I think suborbital female, it has to be pinkish color, and then both have eyelashes. So that's the sexual dimorphism. I'll show one more picture, one more slide. Now you can see the pink suborbital skin here and the ivory colored beak of the female, and the male you can see again black and the cast difference. Whereas the juvenile or the fledgling does not have the cast. Sometimes it may have a small mound or protuberance, and the suborbital skin also is not black and pink, it's somewhat gray and or dull pink. But you don't know whether it is a male or female till up to around 8-9 months of the chick's life or the fledgling's life. So that's how you can easily differentiate the male, female, and the juvenile. Sometimes this gets people get confused with Malabar grey hornbill, but of course it's different. This is the latest distribution as per the eBird data of Indian grey hornbill. So you can see, except Northeast India, the high altitude and Kashmir and Jammu and Kashmir and very dry areas of Rajasthan. Of course, most of the areas of Rajasthan are now already the Indian grey hornbill has occupied because of the Indira Gandhi Nahar. So this is the commonest hornbill found in India, and good thing is it is found in all the big metro cities in areas wherever we have big and huge or old trees, like Mumbai, Bangalore, Chandigarh, Delhi. We have got very good populations of Indian grey hornbill. That's why I selected Indian grey hornbill, and I conducted my studies in Nagpur city in central India. So I was when I decided that I will be doing my PhD on Indian grey hornbill, I had some questions in my mind, and the first was how the finding out the basic breeding behavior, because that this was in 2007, and then even the basic things about the breeding behavior of Indian grey hornbill was not available. Then what is the incubation period? It was not mentioned in Salim Ali's book. How do they keep the nest clean? This is very important question, because not only for Indian grey hornbill, for all other hornbill species. What is the diet, the competition for food, social behavior, and in the intelligent nest? This is just an addition I want to make so that we can think further on the subject of hornbill. So I'll try to cover these points in this small in this 1 hour long presentation. But in 2007, what was the equipment I had? I just had an Olympus, a pair of Olympus binoculars, the Sony Handycam. So I used to take do video recording. Then for still photography, I just had 70 to 300 mm lens, which costs around 8,000 rupees now, and a Canon EOS digital camera. That was my equipment. So I had no hi-fi equipment. And then I was collecting indirect evidence during the study, like collect excreta. And if you collect everything under the nest, that is known as midden, and not only excreta. That means even other fallen material under the nest you have to collect. Then I used to collect data on fruiting phenology, means this, when which trees are having fruits in which season. So every day, 15 days, I used to collect their data. That helps in deciding when the hornbills start breeding. Okay, it was totally in urban habitat, but now with continuous breeding, I'm in touch, and I can speak a little about other species of hornbills also. So you can look at this particular tree. Of course, Indian grey hornbill doesn't need such huge trees, but it was this was a very huge Arjuna tree, and it was in the Maharaj Bagh Garden and Zoo in Nagpur city, and the nest was above this. So we installed a net, which is like 10 feet by 10 feet, to collect midden and midden or excreta and everything means midden on this net. So every day or alternate day we go and collect whatever is there on this net and pack it properly in plastic envelopes with date and for analyzing later. So the last photograph was of the focal nest. So we decided that we will concentrate on this nest, and of course we will take observations from other nests. So I used a method which is known as time budgeting method, in which I take observations for every minute and write down, and then analyze the observations as per the timing and then also collect this with them and also analyze the videos to count how many items the hornbill supplied into the nest. And that time we had video cassettes, and it was also a job to convert those video cassettes to CDs. So this is one nest, and the area where this nest is situated is the central jail, Nagpur. And this is the outer part of central jail, where you are not supposed to enter, but there is no wall. At that time, there was no boundary. So there, here was the nest. And what we tried, I got this kit developed with the help of some intelligent people who repair television sets. This was a battery operated TV set. And we did this, we got this camera and tried putting this camera into this only for 5 minutes, just to check what is the situation inside the nest. That was just a trial. Then we never used it. The good thing is it was successful, and we prepared this kit only with 2,500 rupees at that time. Whereas in Netherlands, one scientist from Netherlands developed such a kit for 2,000 pounds. We developed it for 2,500 rupees. So look at the locations of nest. I have just shown this. This one is here in the main trunk. Then this is on a highway. You can see my motorcycle parked here. And these are the quarters of the forest department and Supreme Court's judge, Bangalore here. Now this tree was felled by the Nagpur Municipal Corporation 3-4 years back. Till then, the hornbills were nesting in this tree. And this is a tree in a veterinary hospital campus where nobody was going there. So it was totally deserted place and very safe for the hornbill. The nest was in the middle of the tree. And this is the children park of the Marasbagh Garden. And there is one nest here. And after 12 years, I visited the nest again, and the hornbills are still there and they are nesting there. So that's the good news. So you can see so much crowd, so many kids playing, shouting. And I used to sit just behind this lady. I had my place here with my camera because I used to get a perfect angle from here to get video shots. So we just go through the breeding cycle and then come to the secrets. So my job was to search nesting cavities, then observe courtship mating, nest preparation, and how the female incarcerates herself or imprisons herself, how she breaks out, how chicks come out, feeding the female and then the chicks, and the breeding success. So the most important thing was courtship. Courtship was very interesting because it started nearly 3 months before actually the female imprisoned herself inside the nesting cavity. So what they do is they start, the male and female move around in an area searching and visiting potential nest cavities. The male is like a good boyfriend. He always carries in his gullet, throat pouch, lots of fruits. And he keeps offering the female these fruits. So whenever she stops accepting it. So he always has got those fruits full of stock in his gullet. So one more interesting thing was the male was offering inedible objects like mud pellets and pieces of bark to the female, whereas he was not into the nest during courtship also. So what the male will do is it will just fly off to some tree like a neem tree, which has got barks like this, bring a piece of bark and offer it to her. And what the female is doing, she plays with this piece of bark and she just raises it up, juggles it, and then crushes it into powder. But she never ate this piece of bark. So I was very much keen in knowing why the male is offering this thing. And I thought like the male was just wasting his time in this and even offering mud pellets to the female. And then I saw the mating started. The mating generally happened near to the nest. And important thing about hornbills is the female has to store the sperm as she cannot come out for mating for every egg. In other species of birds, the mating keeps on happening and every day the eggs get fertilized and the female lays eggs every day or alternate day depending on the size of the bird. But here the female doesn't have the opportunity. So she has to store the sperms for all the eggs she is going to lay inside the cavity because she will be sealed inside the cavity. So the male and female also indulged in something known as playing behavior. Like this includes bill grappling. Bill grappling means they hold each other's beak and pull very gently. So, this is like kissing and pulling each other's tail and passing food to each other. So sometimes the male brought a lizard and for many hours, they were just giving the lizard to each other and nobody was swallowing it. Sometimes the the male's imprisonment arrives, she reduces the number of hours she will spend in feeding or foraging for fruits, and she becomes more and more sedentary. And one or two days before actual imprisonment, she literally stops feeding and foraging, because the male is feeding her, and she enjoys the sunlight. She spends most of her time in breeding and basking in sunlight. So this is a photograph when a male and female is visiting a potential cavity. So the male is like a to-be-married boy. He takes her around, showing different homes. And what he does is he first inspects, he puts his head inside, peeps deep into the cavity, looks into the measurements of the cavity, and then asks her to look. Then she looks into it, and then they move on if the cavity is not good. So they go on inspecting a lot of cavities like this. And so another pair, so this nest was accepted. This is from the children park or Balukdan in the Maharaj Bagh Garden, and this is the male and this is the female here. So they are inspecting the nest cavity again before finally settling. The female settles inside the cavity. So two more pairs. Now you can see the male is ready with a fruit. This is a small people pig, and you can see the cluster pig's fruit or a fig, big one, which is just crushed, and this also cavity was used. Female, so the male is always ready to offer fruits to the female, or even non-vegetarian material like some lizards or snails and carpenter bees. He's always ready and keeps her happy by continuously feeding her and showing her territory, the fruiting tree, showing her and impressing her with his idea that the territory has got a lot of fruiting trees. There is no need of, there is no dearth of vegetarian as well as non-vegetarian food, and also other things which she may need, like the mud balls and the bark pieces and everything he keeps on supplying. So he is continuously offering these things, beetles and grasshoppers, and that's how the courtship goes on. And they, of course, this is a photograph of the bill grappling or kissing behavior. So I will just click on next to show you that there is something like a dance in the Indian grey hornbill. Both the male and female moves their heads and tails in a synchronized order. I hope you can see in these few photographs. So only these 3-4 photographs. It's like some dance steps. I now feel that I should have taken video so that I could have shown you better courtship behavior. So when the female is ready, she starts entering the nest cavity and sits there inside the nest cavity for a few minutes. Then she increases the duration of her stay inside the nest cavity and starts sealing the nest cavity's entrance with the mud pellets supplied by the male. And even she puts some mud pellets before she enters into the cavity. And she starts working like a mason. Now you can see the female also, she has brought a mud ball here, and the male is inspecting inside the cavity. So both bring mud pellets, she collects inside, and when she sits inside, she starts plastering the nest entrance with the mud pellets like a mason. And she does it very well, I will say. So you can see now the male is giving the mud pellet to the female. And of course, the nest is cleaned of any debris, particularly as all cavities are used by parakeets, rose-ring parakeets, and common mynas and other cavity nesting birds. And finally, the female seals herself and she stays inside. And you can see the cavity is now closed, and there is one vertical slit through which now the female will be managing everything, and the male will be supplying everything to the female. And this is her gateway to the outside world. Now you can see the female is there. You can see the beak of the female, and you can see some little bit of excreta here, which she is throwing out. And this is the slit, how it's, if though it is vertical, it's slightly slanted always. So she seals herself, and this is what I said. So the sticky mud is used, and of course, people say she also uses her excreta. But of course, when she is sitting inside and she has to pass on her excreta just using her body force, some excreta will always stick onto this plaster from inside and gets mixed up with the mud. So when she is doing this masonry work, one day it happens that it becomes so narrow that she cannot come out. And that is the day when we say, now she is imprisoned, and that from that day onwards, we count as one. Because on that day or on the next day, she lays her first egg and everything of her life or Arnby's life cycle is counted from this day. This is an example of how the female is sitting inside and how the chick is sitting inside the nest. This is a cross-section of the nest of great pied hornbill, and this is the same hornbill because of which the BNHS got its mascot or logo, the great hornbill here. This is the same bird. It was named as William and it stayed in BNHS, in the BNHS head office for 22 hours. So after its death, BNHS office was named as Hornbill House. So this is kept in the Prince of Wales Museum, now also known as Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj Vastu Sangrahalaya. So you can see how they are sitting inside the nest. Okay, the breeding cycle of Indian grey hornbill or any hornbill species is or can be divided into three steps. Stage one is the female, only female is inside the nest, and she lays egg and she is incubating the eggs. Second stage starts when the eggs hatch and the chicks come out. So the female is there with the chicks. So this is 1 month and this is 2 months, again 2 months. And after that, after another 1 month, I will say the female comes out after 60 days and then only chicks are there for another 30 days. So this is all 30 days, 30, total becomes 3 months. And the chicks are altricial. That means when they are born, they are naked, the skin is pink and they are blind. So their eyes are yet to open. And when the female, in Indian grey hornbill, what happens is, after 60 days, the chicks are grown enough, like little bit, and there might be a space constraint or whatever reasons, I don't know. But the female breaks the nest wall and comes out, but the chicks are inside. So what happens here is the chicks have to reseal the cavity entrance without any prior experience. And if there is a male, that male will be resealing the nest entrance only once in his life, because once it comes out, it is never going to enter any nest cavity. So this is a very interesting part here. Between stage 2 and stage 3. But there are some species like the Malabar grey hornbill, where the female also stays inside the nest for the complete duration till here, and the chicks and the female come out together. So there are different ways, slightly different ways, how the chicks and female fledge out from the cavity. So when the female is inside and the chicks are inside, the chicks need a lot of proteins and a lot of good nutritious food, because they need to develop their bones and wings. So the male has to supply more of diet or non-vegetarian food. And so he supplies a lot of garden lizards. So whatever animal food is available in that area, in Nagpur, I have seen garden lizards must be very abundant. And good thing is garden lizards have breeding season in summer. So they are displaying on vantage points. So it becomes very easy for the hornbills to look at them and just dive and get it for the female. So the hornbill crushes its head and gets the garden lizard to the nest. You can see the excreta also is here. So when the hornbill brings it, it is the garden lizard is, the tail is peeping out from the beak and the mouth of the garden lizard is inside the throat. But when it delivers to the nest, the mouth is given first to the female. So the male takes care of the female and nestlings during the incarceration period or during the imprisonment. So I am waiting for the good news, because the female is there inside the nest and hornbill is feeding. The good news comes when I find that under the nest, on the net, I find egg cells. That means there is good news in the nest and the babies are born. So I don't have to put any camera, but there is a probability that the female may not throw the egg cells out, and then you are totally blind about what's happening. One more thing is, it also throws bark pieces. Yeah, one more thing happens is the male also keeps supplying bark pieces to the female inside the nest, mud pellets, and these are also collected on the net. One more thing which I get is the molded feathers of the female. So I collect it and label every feather with a name. I give a small tag to every feather, because then I have to find out what is happening about the molding. So about the incubation period, I was trying to find out. And as I said, not every female was throwing the eggshell out. Might be she was eating it, or it just lied inside the nest cavity because it is very dark inside. So she's not bothered, and the eggshell must be lying in some corner. But whenever I got eggshells, I just write down in my diary, then I get it. So the minimum is I got on 29 days after she is incarcerated. That means the incubation period of Indian grey hornbill is 29 days, or it can be even less than that. Okay, so it can be even less than 29 days. But and these are the remarks. So sometimes nestlings disappear. Sometimes the female, this particular thing, the female came out after 33 days. So the nesting failed. Okay, when the female is imprisoned, what happens? The male is supplying. Now you can see the male is supplying fruits, and the female stays inside for 65 to 70 days. And that was in 12 nests I observed. After 65 days or 65 to 70 days, the female breaks the plaster with her beak, and you can hear it down. Even if you are standing on the ground, even if you are around 500 feet away from the tree, you can hear that banging she is doing to break the nest wall. And the nest wall is very strong. You can see the layers here. You can see the seeds of pigs. And you can also see the exoskeleton parts of the beetles, which the female has eaten and passed through the excreta. So she needs a lot of energy to break it, and she comes out. And when she comes out, it is very difficult to come out. As if you are observing it, you may think that she is stuck in, and you may think she needs help. So it is a very excruciating experience for her, I think. So when the female comes out, she helps the male in feeding the chicks which are there inside the nest cavity. You can see now the hole is open. Here is the male and here is the female. The female brought a garden lizard, so she also helps in getting provisioning, like feed and veg and non-veg, everything for the chicks. So this is a summary of what I got about the fruits. And something which is a word which is used about hornbills, the keystone species or keystone diet species. And for Indian grey hornbill in urban habitat, the keystone diet species is only two species, that is people and banyan, Phagus religiosa and Phagus bengalensis, banyan tree. And these two trees are very, very important for the conservation and survival of hornbills in cities. And because these trees are protected by religious feelings in India, these trees survive in cities, and that's why in big cities we have got a lot of Indian grey hornbills. Of course, Indian grey hornbills also take roots of the other plants or trees, like Bipidacellus, Chichibillai, and then kirni, and non-vegetarian food is also provided, besides the leaf matter. So these are also important, but the most important is to fix. Of course, if you are in Northeast, might be these two trees may not be the most important, but some other species of figs will be there. So I'll just show you some of the food items. This is the people or Ficus religiosa, the banyan tree, burgut, people, cluster pig or bular. So very important. And the kirni, nowadays this plant is becoming rare in cities. This ixura, then bear, of course our bear, then neem, this Azadirachta indica, gaikum fruits. Of course, these get wholly digested, and you don't get any seeds in the excreta, so you don't know how many fruits the hornbills have eaten. These are the Chichibillai, which we also like to eat. Then palm fruits. Of course, these are the garden palms. Then shaitut. I don't know how they managed to get shaitut. I never saw any plant of shaitut nearby, but the hornbills were bringing these. Then bakul fruits. These are also very sweet fruits. Mimosum, selingi. One more interesting food item was the poisonous fruits of yellow oleander, Kevesia. So these fruits are poisonous, and I have seen even Asian quail, this is my photograph, feeding on these poisonous fruits. So not many species of hornbills are reported to feed on poisonous fruits of yellow oleander. There are only few species like the red-winged bulbul, red-breasted bulbul, jungle babbler, and few more species. Yeah, among the animal diet or the non-vegetarian diet, the garden lizards was most important because it has got a big volume or weight. Then the snails, the carpenter bees, and grasshoppers. Other food items which I observed was the maharuk or the Ailanthus excelsa. This has got medicinal plant. Even my mother used to give me this the kada of this or concoction, the concoction of the leaves of this. Cure me of the helminths, ascaris. And then shaitut, I have seen it feeding on shaitut leaves. And my friend Karun also saw it feeding on papaya trees, then papaya fruits. Then, of course, this is a recent record, Ajay Gadikar from Indore. He reported Nengre hornbills feeding on rotis, and that also taken from garbage. And of course, last month, somebody from Pune also reported Indian grey hornbill picking up rotis from her window. And there are videos on Facebook. So after 90 days, 93 days, the chick, first chick breaks the wall, which it has himself done when the female had fledged. And it breaks the wall and comes out. Now you can see there is no horn, but there is just a small little bit of mound, like, or you get a hint that there will be a cask in future. And because it has never seen sunlight, so the most important thing is it loves sunlight, basking in sunlight. So this is a chick we had rescued. It was there for, at my house for 3 days, and after 3 days we found out the parents of this hornbill, and the parents accepted this bird and took it away with them. That was a very nice experience. Then I understood and certain things about the behavior, especially bigger fruits. Like if the hornbill, if I offer this chick jamun seeds, the jamun fruits, the seeds come out from the mouth and not through the excreta. That's very important. I was thinking like it is through the excreta. So the breeding success in Nagpur was very less. In 16 attempts, only 15 chicks came out. So most of the times the nesting failed, and the nestlings disappeared during the period of 3 days when the female had come out and the chicks are required to seal the nest. That is the time when the chicks disappear. And during the first year, I could not find any dead chicks because I was not knowing what's happening. But during the second year of my study, I was aware that these 3 days are very important. So I kept a vigil, like every day morning I went there, and I found one dead chick, and I even found one egg, which was broken. Now you can see here that there is no horn, and this is around 1 month old chick. So let us go to the puzzles. My most important question to which I had was, when the female is sealed inside and there is only a small little slit for her to pass on excreta, how she keeps the nest clean? Because just imagine the female, when the female is alone inside the nest cavity, what she is doing, she turns around, aims with her anus or cloaca, whatever you see, exactly at the slit, and then pumps it or squirts it through that particular slit. Just imagine aiming from the backside. It's very difficult. I used to see Mithun Chakravarti aiming from back with his pistol. Nobody else can do in actual life except our Mithunda. So this hornbill female has to aim from the backside exactly at the slit and then squirt her excreta. But she does it very well. But when the chicks hatch, how can they do it? So my friend suggested might be the chicks sit on her back and she does the direction orientation. Of course, I did not believe this. So there are, I'm just mentioning why, what other birds do, like sunbirds. First, let us look at bee eaters. So the nests are very dirty for bee eaters and kingfishers, which are also hole nesting birds like the hornbills. Then we have sunbirds and robins. Here the excreta is passed on in a capsule or a fecal sac. So what they do is when the parents come, these chicks just turn around, turn their back towards the parent, and the parent know that they want to pass on the poop. So what they do is they just take the fecal sac in their beak and throw it far away so that no predators can find their nest. In open nest, the excreta can be squirted with physical force just away from the nest, like in eagles. But they, in house crows, I have seen that the excreta is eaten by parents most of the time. And whenever the chicks pass on the excreta in the nest itself, the crows will come and find out the excreta and eat every bit of that excreta pieces. But there are some birds which even the nest, even if the nests are open, they will make the nest dirty. For example, rock pigeons in these cities, or feral pigeons and vultures, their nests are very dirty, and from distance you can smell vulture nest. You can see, even if it is in a cliff, you can see those white marks, or far away from half a kilometer, that there is a vulture nesting. So they are known to have dirty nests. So considering the amount of figs, because figs have got huge quantity of water, that's why hornbills don't drink water. So considering that this, they get a lot of water. So that is why their excreta is semi-solid, or you can say semi-liquid. And if the 2-3 chicks and the female, of course, female, she is passing on her excreta outside. If all the chicks do their potty inside the nest, I am sure the liquid will fill up the nest and everybody is going to die. That means they have some way of throwing this excreta out. So, and if the nest is not clean, it can, what is the problem? It can attract ants and predators. So this, as I mentioned, female squirts her excreta from the nest lid. And this excreta, or some excreta, lies at the nest entrance, which I have shown in the few, in the, some photographs. That is because some female must be throwing some excreta from the nest floor using her beak just out from the that particular slit. So I was trying for the answer, and I was studying the midden to get answers about the how many seeds of this plant, how many seeds of this plant, because I needed to analyze what is the diet of Indian grey hornbill. So I was studying the all the packets of excreta or midden which I had collected from the nest, and I found that there were eggshells and there were bark pieces like this. So what I did was I collected all the bark pieces at one place, and I was photographing those bark pieces, and I realized that every bark piece has got excreta attached to it. So besides the bark pieces, I got the fruits, molted feathers, nail shells, other debris. So then I remembered that hornbill male was giving bark to the cavity inmates, or the female as well as to the chicks every day, and even during courtship. Okay, throughout the nesting period and after the particularly hatching, you can see excreta here. After the hatching of the eggs, the male increased the supply of bark pieces to the nest. So these were the bark pieces I had, and I kept them on a scale generally for taking measurements if there is any doubt. And I was photographing, you can see this all at this white dirty marks on it, and it clicked to me that yes, something is happening. So next day when I went to the nest, and I was just looking up for what's going to fall next, and as soon as the next piece of bark fell down, I picked it up and I found that there was excreta stuck on it. So what must be happening inside the nest? So when the male supplies the bark pieces, since the female breaks the bark pieces or just drops it in the cavity, thus lining the nest cavity or on the cavity floor, the chicks defecate on the nest floor, and thus excreta gets absorbed and adsorbed over the surface of the bark pieces. So these are the bark pieces with the fresh excreta are adsorbed over its surface. You might be knowing there are two things, absorption and adsorption. So absorption is the when the water is absorbed, and adsorption is when it sticks on the surface. So these bark pieces with the excreta are thrown out by the female from time to time. So I am talking about this absorption, maximum liquid inside, and adsorption, adsorbs excreta on its surface. So this the crust, the bark needs to be crispy and very dry. Then only this thing will happen. Now, when the male was offering these crispy bark pieces to the female, and she was juggling and breaking it, she was trying to understand whether the bark is crispy, whether the bark is dry, and whether the male understands her need when she will be inside the cavity, because it has to be dry and crispy. So that is how she is judging the male, whether he understands her requirements. Then also she is judging him by his territory, by the amount of food he is offering, and the amount of his understanding of her needs. So this is how the female takes care of her nest sanitation, using the bark pieces And what are the bark pieces they were giving? I saw the male actually physically collecting the pieces of bark from Asiatic Rector Indica, mango and mahogany, and sometimes from more often on rain tree, and less from goldmoor and arjuna tree. If you look into Ayurveda books, all these plants have medicinal properties. They are insect repellents and have anti-helminthic properties and have vermicidal properties. And I am sure this may not be a sheer coincidence, and it may be an understanding or learning by the hornbills. So what happens after fledging? Fledging means when the chicks come out, what happens? As soon as the chicks come out of the nest, I saw within 10 minutes, the common miners rushed into the cavity and went inside and started throwing everything from the nest cavity. That means whatever the hornbills had left inside, and everything was gathered on the net. And for that particular day, I collected everything, and I found that this is the nest wall plaster, and these two are the excreta cakes, and so much of excreta was lying inside the nest. That means there were downy feathers also. You can see some downy feathers stuck to these. That means the hornbill babies were just sitting on a heap of excreta inside the nest cavity, though they were doing so much of things. You can see some bark pieces here. Even after so much of idea thinking, or might be thinking of using the bark pieces, there was still a lot of excreta. And when we found one vacated nest, and I sent my friend up to see whether the chicks are still there, he said that it stinks very badly. So that means even after taking so much care, the hornbill nests are dirty inside, or they have got a lot of excreta inside. That means it attracts a lot of ectoparasites or skin infestation. And if you search, you will find a lot of research papers about hornbills, that they carry a lot of load of skin infestation or ectoparasites. So what do they do? Get rid of these. When the chicks come out, they love sunlight. So they take a lot of sunlight, sunbath. And one more thing, what hornbills keep on doing is they take dust bath. Just to mention, most of the photographs of other species are taken from the internet, and I thank all the photographers. So you can see hornbills take dust bath, and they rub their belly vigorously on the ground to get rid of those infestations. And all the birds which nest in cavities, like the beetles, like the rollers, hoopoes, and they have the dirt, and the kingfishers, they have the dirty nest. I think except the kingfishers, because they take bath so many times. Others take a lot of dust bath to get rid of these infestations. And also sparrows, because they also nest in cavities. Even ground hornbills, they also take dust bath. It's their favorite activity. And these type of photographs are very common, coming from Karnataka, Malabar pied hornbills. And of course, there are photographs of Indian grey hornbills also. And let us see this video. I hope it plays. I'm trying to play it from Facebook. I hope it plays. So that I don't have to download it from somebody else's account. And that's why I try to do this. Hope it plays. Yes, it's opening. Just few seconds video. So you can see the Malabar grey hornbills, Malabar pied hornbills taking dust bath in this video. See how they do it. It's only a few seconds video, but it's worth watching. That's why I wanted to share it. So that's how they take the dust bath, and I don't know how to go back.
Raj, you'll have to share the full screen. I think you're only sharing a presentation right now, so we can't see your Facebook screen.
Is it?
Okay. Can you do screen share again and then now, select the top left option, which is the entire screen?
Yeah, I have selected. Now can you see the hornbill?
No, not yet.
No? What do I do? Can you repeat?
Click on screen share again, the green button, and then select the option in the top left.
Yeah. Oh, yes.
Yeah, now you can see. Yes.
So these are the Malabar pied hornbills taking dust bath. So must be very mesmerizing phenomenon. I have seen Indian grey hornbills doing this, but not in so many numbers. I have seen only few of them doing it. So I go back to my original presentation.
Yeah.
I don't know. So there is one more. I'll try to show again. It works. Again, I have to do that same.
Okay. Oh, yes.
Only few seconds, we can. Please. Oh, here. Just a few seconds. This is taken by Sanjay Nafde in Nagpur. It's very interesting, where I did my PhD. It's not happening. Might be I stopped my video.
No, I don't think so. I think it's bandwidth.
Okay, so this is one video which shows Indian grey hornbills. Okay, no problem. So this is the reason why Indian grey hornbills do take a lot of dust bath, because they have a lot of skin infestation and ectoparasites because of the still dirtiness. And all the birds, most of the birds which nest in cavities and holes will take either dust bath or more water bath and more sun bath to get rid of the ectoparasites. Okay, one more very interesting thing about hornbills is the social interactions. To make the presentation more beautiful, I will share some photographs of other species, as Indian grey hornbill is not so charismatic and so beautiful looking, though it's, for me, it's beautiful. So the most important thing is aerial jousting. Aerial jousting means two hornbills playing in the air, and sometimes they clash their bills, and when they clash, that is known as cusk butting. So these are very interesting, and these interactions can be male-male, male-female, parent-immature, and of course, there are reports of female-female interactions also. So these are two male hornbills you can see. So one is airborne and the other is there. It's perched. So this one is challenging the one. And now they grappled. They are grappling each other's bill. So this is known as bill grappling, but two males. Okay. During the courtship, I have shown you male and female. So that was very gentle and it was just like kissing. So now this hornbill also got excited and also leaving the perch, and both have left the perch. And you can imagine I am standing on the ground and they must be high up in the highest branch of that particular tree. So they are high up in the tree, and now this is aerial jousting, and then they grapple bills and then they fall down. So then you can see that they are holding the perches very strongly and pulling each other with strength. When they are pulling, this hornbill can't remain in the position, and finally loses his balance, so he falls down. So, but these beaks are still locked. So with the weight of this hornbill also comes down, and it comes swirling down, and it's very interesting to see how it happens. So look at this, how it's happening. So it's a very powerful, they use a lot of strength and want to prove that I am stronger than you. So here also, both these hornbills fell literally in front of me, around 15 feet away from me. And it was very interesting to see this fight, and there was a female watching. These photographs are taken by Vinod Goyal in Delhi. And very interesting, you can see two males fighting on the ground, because when they were fighting in the air, they fell down and they still continued the fight. And now you can see how the fight went on. After the aerial jousting, they fell down, and see, they can injure each other also. These are females. So this is very interesting. I don't know how to explain the reason. Now the females are still, you can see the beak in beak, but they are fighting. And other birds, now you have here common mynas, two common mynas and one house crow. as audience for the fight. So they're also enjoying their fight. And here again, what happens during the fight, sometimes the male will break some dry branches to prove that I'm stronger and I can break even your bones like that, dhamki, just giving a dhamki or threat. And there was one kite, and this hornbill just broke the kite with its beak in a fraction, in 2-3 seconds. And that was very interesting to see, as if it had got very angry. And this is known as manipulating behavior. So these are photographs taken by others. And you can see the Indian grey hornbills, two Indian grey hornbills high up in the sky, coming towards each other, and then locking their bills and then falling down. See, it's just like parachuting. And they, when they are falling down, they do swirling. So let me try this one, because this one is very beautiful video. And if I can play it, it will be very nice. I'll share this again. Let it open first. Oh. Oh, okay. So I'm sure that was nice. I loved this video so much. I have seen it so many times, and I had never seen such a beautiful video of hornbills cast budding. And I had heard these. I have myself seen Oriental pied hornbills, Malabar pied hornbills, Indian grey hornbills, bill grappling and cast butting, but not in the air like this, and not great hornbills. I have seen great hornbills even in flocks, never indulging in cast butting or aerial jousting. So this was the best one, the best video I could find on Facebook, which was easy to share. So this is this one more photograph. You can see the behavior, and of course the oriental pied hornbills. Again, you can see how they are trying to hold each other's beak, and this is also very, very interesting. And the first photographs which came from India was by Sachin Rai and A.K. Raju. And there was one research paper on this behavior in Indian birds. And this was just when I was doing my study on Indian grey hornbills. And when I found this similar behavior, I was like, oh my God, this is too good. And I had the camera which I had was like, it failed me in many ways. I could not take pictures like this. I have seen Indian grey hornbills doing this in the air, but I could never take it. These are Malabar pied hornbills, and the best pictures, this one is the best and most famous picture by Sachin Rai. Okay, so that was about the social behavior. And the social behavior, the male-male interaction is of course to prove the strength, who is stronger. The male's trying to say that I am stronger than you, like that. And when it is the parents and chicks, it's mostly the gentle bill grappling behavior. And if it is male and female, it's the courtship. So those are the explanations which I have. I don't have any explanation why the female-female cast butting should happen, why they should grapple bills, or why they should fight. So I don't have any explanation for that. Okay, let's look at the problems the hornbills face. The first problem is food competition, and second problem is nest competition. Food competition they can manage, because no bird will fight with hornbills because they have got huge beaks. So I'm just skipping it and look at the nest competition. The rose ring parakeets, they are so numerous in every city, so they will be fighting for every nest. And whenever the hornbill comes to the nest, they will create ruckus, and every time there is chaos. The common myna, every day, early morning to evening, every day she will come and inquire the into the nest, and very inquisitive, and see and check whether the hornbill is still there and whether she has come out. As soon as the chicks come out, within 10 minutes the female occupied the nests, mostly in most of the nests. And there is nest competition. You can see this is the nest, and the female is inside. And you can see the male is feeding, and after 1 minute, the Alexandrian parakeets. This photograph is not from Nagpur. This is from Mumbai, from Baikala Zoo, also known as the Rani Bagh. So I took this in Rani Bagh. So the Alexandrian parakeets also compete for nest cavities in places wherever they are. They are there. Then we have spotted owlets also. Then scops owl and all owls which want the cavities for roosting as well as for nesting. They compete with the hornbills. And of course, woodpeckers, they compete in one way, but they are good in another way, in the sense that they are the primary cavity nesters. That means they are the ones who excavate these cavities. So hornbills are not primary hole nesters. They are secondary hole nesters. So woodpeckers make the nest cavities and hornbills take over, or common mynas and parakeets, they take over the cavities which are actually excavated by the woodpeckers. But there are natural tree cavities also which are used by hornbills, because especially bigger hornbills like the great hornbills, the woodpeckers can't make such big cavities. So they nest in natural tree cavities. Then we have competition even from smaller birds like Oriental magpie robins, and of course the Indian house crows. They were the torturers of hornbills, because they attack the hornbills, and when the chicks fledge, particularly especially in cities, the crows really torture the chicks and many times injure the chicks. What is new? The most important thing is my friend Mr. Goel from Delhi sent me a photographs like this, and then Ajay Gadikar from Indore sent me photographs. Now we have seen how the sexual dimorphism, and you can see the female is here on top and the male is down. Here, this is the male. You can see this is the beak and this is the female. So this is known as reciprocal mounting by the female. So this is very rare, and though there are many records from all across the world, there are very few records in India. I have seen similar behavior in spotted owlets, but of course there is no sexual dimorphism in spotted owlets, so I can't say whether it was a male female or both were males or both were females. But I have seen reciprocal mounting, both birds mounting on each other alternatively. So this is a very interesting sequence of photographs taken by Ajay Gadikar. You can see the male here. So as soon as the male did the mounting, the female reciprocated. So this is a very interesting behavior seen by bird watchers in two places. This is in Indore, and they were Mr. Vinod Goel from Delhi also took photographs in Delhi. Then I could never find this. Of course, it is reported that Indian grey hornbill feeds on parakeet chicks, but I could never see it. We only saw a chick being brought by our hornbills, but we never knew what the bird was. So from Ajay Gadikar, who is studying hornbills in Indore, he got the 100% proof that the parakeet had roosting parakeet chicks. And what is new? Indian grey hornbill nesting in a hole in a concrete wall. It's very new observation again by Ajay Gadikar, and you can see the hole here, and it is sealed and used by hornbills. And what is new? Indian grey hornbills using artificial nest boxes. I need to thank Vishwajit Naik from Pune. He has done exemplary work. Now this year he had two pairs of hornbills nesting in his Bangalore premises. He has got so many nest boxes put up in the premises. So two of them were occupied by Indian grey hornbills. And last many years, he is doing good recording, video recordings of that. I hope he comes out with good YouTube videos on that. And I spoke to him. He is doing that. So hornbills adopt artificial nest boxes. If you provide good quality nest boxes with particular size of the hole. Okay, the last thing about my presentation is intelligent nests. These are being used, this is also of course artificial nest, but these are intelligent nests in some ways. So these were used by for reintroduction of hornbills in Pulau Ubin Island in Singapore. You can see this is a huge nest, must be 2.5 feet to 3 feet tall. And this was particularly used for a reintroduction program of the Oriental pied hornbill. And this nest has a camera and a weighing machine and a measuring tape inside. So when the hornbill is sitting on the floor itself, they have marked a scale, permanent scale. So the size of the egg and size of the female, everything is seen there. So this is one more intelligent nest. And when the hornbill is sitting on this perch is nothing but a weighing machine. And this weighing machine is attached to a computer laptop down in a cabin just nearby to the nest, because this is an artificial nest box on a iron pole. So when the hornbill comes, the weighing machine tells what is the weight of that hornbill. And when the hornbill is flying off, It again tells you what was the weight when it flew away. That means how much of fruit or how much weight of food material the hornbill male or female, whoever is there, has provided inside the nest. That exactly you can get. So that type of research is being done in Singapore. And the hornbill reintroduction program has been very successful in Pulau Ubin Island. And if you are lucky, when you go to hornbill, when you go to Singapore next time, look around in the trees, big trees. Might be you see a hornbill near a railway station or near a bus stand in Singapore. I was lucky. I saw the oriental pied hornbill seen wild in Singapore. There is a nest near a bus stop, which is occupied by hornbills. So these type of things are being done in other countries, and in India also, Amitha Bachchan from Kerala, he is also doing, trying to install artificial nest for great hornbills in the southern western Ghats in Kerala, where the Kadar tribe is there. So let us hope he gets success. I don't have any update on whether he has got success. And let me tell you, hornbill was extinct in Singapore, and now it is there in Singapore city itself. So that's a success story. This is a list of research papers I published because of my interest in hornbills. And just going through, these are short notes. This is my PhD thesis, which was published by Lambert. And this is my Marathi book on Indian grey hornbill, Mayalu Dhanesh Achyutupeet. So those who are students and who understand Marathi can read these. This was published at the hands of PCCF during Master Pakshi Mitra Sambilan, and then I published Indian Grey Hornbill, my book, Unraveling the Secrets. This is on Google Play Books, and it's anybody can buy it. My supervisor, PhD supervisor, Dr. Tara, my co-supervisor, and my friends from Nagpur, Tosar sir and Dr. Anil Pimpalapure. And this is when we attended the Hornbill conference in Singapore 2009, and thanks to my friends. And I want to thank you all. You can see the hornbills here. One species here. I think this is one is the artificial cast, and these are the natural ones. And thanks to all these photographers whose photographs I have used. And there's no, I tried to give due credits to all of them. Thank you all for attending my talk, and over to Nikhil for further proceedings. Thanks, Nikhil.
Thanks, Raju. That was really nice. And we'll now open the chat for anybody else to ask any questions to Raju, please. We open the chat now.
Okay, I stopped share.
Yeah, you can stop the share. We open the chat.
So somebody will read the questions or I have to read?
Yes, Kavi will read the questions to you. And Kavi, can you show the question of the day which Raju can ask?
Yes, give me a second. So as most of you know, one of the partners for our talks is Zayas, and at the end of every talk we ask a question of the day to the viewers. One person who gives the correct answer gets an opportunity to win either a Zayas binocular harness or a Zayas cleaning kit. The answers need to be submitted on www.delhibirdfoundation.org/contest. We'll be posting this question on our Facebook page and Facebook group as well. So you can refer to the question and link after this talk. Raju, would you want to go ahead and ask the question to our viewers today?
Yes. So my question is, what is the peculiar thing about the beaks of hornbills when they are still nestlings? And this is for all hornbills. Okay. So that's my question.
Great. And please don't answer in the chat box. Please go to delhibirdfoundation.org/contest website and submit your answers over there. Also, like I mentioned in the beginning, we have a talk by Ashish Pitti on Saturday, 15th August at 5 p.m. It's called The Return Bird, A Journey into Ornithological Bibliography. And we have another talk on Sunday, 16th August at 5 p.m. again by Sudhir Vyas. The talk is called Birding Across Borders. So hope to see all of you for those talks next weekend. We'll just start the question and answer session. Also, as an update, a lot of people keep asking us where they can view the recordings of these talks. So we would like to tell you that the Delhi Bird Foundation YouTube page is live. I'll be sharing the link for that in the chat box. You can share and subscribe to that YouTube link and access all the previous talks that we've had since the beginning, as well as any future talks that we record and post over there. Okay. We have a lot of questions coming in. Just give me 1 second. Okay, so the first question we have is from Pranath, who's asking, why do hornbills have eyelashes? Any particular reason besides keeping dust out of their eyes? And do any other birds also have eyelashes?
Yes. Some other birds do have. I think barbets have eyelashes. I think they are, you see, they are, I'm not 100% sure, but the reason could be, besides dust, the reason could be hornbills are cavity nesting birds, and they need eyelashes because they may bang on to the cavity many times. So that's to protect the eyes. That should be the reason, logically. Okay. Yes.
Okay. Another question is from Anirudh, who's asking, how many pairs of hornbills can generally be found nesting per tree?
Yes, there can be two pairs. That is what I think. More than that, it's... I don't expect anyways, because sometimes, because they are territorial, they fight, they don't want other males to come nearby. But if these are two different species, that is known as sympatric species, for example, great hornbill and Indian grey hornbill can have a nest in the same tree, but not two Indian grey hornbills in the same tree. I don't think, nobody has seen it.
So you haven't seen it yet. Okay. Another interesting question is, what happens if the male hornbill dies while the female is still sealed in the nest?
This is the most precarious day for the female if the male dies, because he is totally dependent on male. Now it depends on what is the situation of the female, because this female molds her feathers inside the cavity, especially the flight feathers. Flight feathers means wings and tails. CVC molds all of them. So if the male dies immediately after she has molted, it's very difficult for her to survive. So what she does is, if she has already laid the eggs, first thing is she tries to starve off as much as possible. Then she eats the eggs, realizing that the male is not coming back. Then she finishes off the eggs. Again, the male doesn't come. Then she breaks the wall and comes out. But because she cannot fly properly, there is a chance that she may not be able to forage for food, and she may fall prey to a predator. But she tries to keep herself very, very secretive in those days. But if she already has chicks, she has no choice but to eat the chicks and survive till she can manage herself. Then she breaks out and comes out. There is no way. And that has been observed in other species of hornbills, especially in Singapore, because they have got video cameras. So they have got videos of female eating the chicks, and in some species also, of course, elder chicks are also reported to eat the very younger chicks in some species, very rarely. But this happens very rarely. Okay.
Okay, quite okay. Interesting. Another question from Rupa is, do hornbills steal other birds' nests? So you did mention how they... Some hornbills use cavities made by woodpeckers, but have you observed them stealing nests of other birds?
Of course, these cavities are, the cavities is like a scarce commodity in the forest. Okay, there are limited cavities, so the cavities are always occupied by somebody. So the hornbills have to appropriate the nest. In all my 16 nests I studied in that time, all were occupied by common minnows and rose ring parakeets. So they just throw their nesting material out. If the chicks are there, they must be throwing out or eating them. I have not seen that, but I have seen every day throwing their nesting material out. So there is no way. They have to snatch the nests of other birds. That's the only way. The life goes on. But as soon as the hornbill's last chick comes out of the nest cavity is open for others to compete and take over. Even for rose ring parakeets, Alexandrian parakeets, and common minnows, what all whole nesting birds.
Okay, got it. Another question from M. Reddy is, what are some fast growing trees which can be planted apart from papaya for hornbills, since the ficus family grows very slowly?
Yes. I think I know only one tree which grows faster, that is jamun. Other trees, I don't know. I am not very good in trees, but that's one tree which grows very fast and can get fruits within few years. Mm-hmm. That is one. And hornbills love it. And I think neem tree, the Asia directa indica. That also, I think, grows fast. I think within 5 years, or it should have fruits. And they love neem fruits. I have shown in the presentation.
Okay. Another question. We'll take the last few questions now. One question is, what are the major threats to hornbills besides competition for nests?
Oh, major threat is habitat loss. And in some areas, they're poaching by tribals. Because tribals know that the female seals are herself. So they just go and take the female and chicks out and eat. Secondly, it is also hunted for their beautiful feathers because it is there and for the caste. So from the caste, they make the headgear. I have shown Narendra Modi's picture. So tribals make headgear from that. Of course, we have Aparajita, who is working on this aspect in a small part in Northeast India. But other parts of Northeast India, it's being hunted for the caste, for their beautiful feathers. So in Nagaland, which celebrates hornbill festival, there is no hornbill. That's what I know. So the situation is very bad. The hornbills are very easy to hunt. And it's they are hunted in most parts of Northeast India, except where we have good scientists working, like Aparajita now, and we are in Kerala now. So the major problem is the selective hunting. Second is it's a huge problem, habitat loss, because oil plantation, palm plantation is taking place now. You must have read in newspapers that the government of India is also starting a campaign to have plantation, palm oil plantations in Northeast India. That is what has happened in Philippines, Malaysia, Thailand, all those Southeast Asian countries, and destroyed huge swaths of forests where the hornbills live. That's the biggest threat. That is this plantation and destruction of forest. We have zoom type of cultivation in South Northeast India. Zoom means entire forest patches are cleared for agriculture every few years. Then after a few years, they go on to the next patch, clean the next patch. So that. You can see bald, many bald hills if you are traveling in Southeast, Northeast India. That's one of the reasons. That means the amount of forest, the area of forest is going down. Automatically, the number of birds will also go down. Those are the main threats.
Okay. The last couple of questions for the day. First is, what is the average lifespan of the Indian grey hornbill? And another related question is, what is the average clutch size of the eggs of the Indian grey hornbill?
The Indian grey hornbill is 1 to 3, around 3 eggs is actually average clutch size, but sometimes they are known to lay 5 eggs. And lifespan, I don't know, but it is said to be surviving for 10-15 years. But there are other species of hornbills which are known to survive for 50 years. So it depends on size. Bigger the size, longer is the lifespan. So great hornbill is known to live around 40 to 50 years. So Indian grey hornbill, we don't have actual studies of with rings or with tags, but they are known to survive for 10 to 15 years because there are birds in zoos, especially in Singapore Zoo and other places. So smaller hornbills survive for shorter duration. Bigger the size, longer the duration. And for eggs, smaller the hornbill, more eggs. Bigger the hornbill, less eggs. That's one generalization, I will say.
Got it. Yeah, okay, so last question for the day is, do hornbills, like some other birds, follow monogamy? So like, it's known that the sarus crane pairs mates with the same bird for the entire lives. Is that a behavior that's also seen with hornbills?
It is believed, but there is no scientific evidence. Nobody has done the tagging and actual marking of hornbills to prove that they are monogamous for life or pairing for life. If you are saying pairing for life, there is no proof, but it is believed that they pair for life. And about monogamy, there are studies conducted about at least one species which proved that they are 100% loyal to each other. So there was no extra pair copulation or mating seen in that particular species. And also, there are some studies, means only few names about great hornbill. There also the monogamy has been established in hornbills. That's the good thing. But in there is doubt that there is some lafda happening in some species, particularly ground hornbills in Africa. not 100% proved that they have adultery. So most of the time, all hornbill species are still considered to be monogamous, at least for the season. For life, we need further research and evidence, because nobody wants to catch these birds, because they are arboreal birds, very difficult to catch and not good to catch in breeding season. So might be somebody will do it.
Got it. Great. I think we'll close with that. A lot of you were asking about the question of the day, so I'll put up the screen again. Here's the link where you can submit your answers. You can take a photograph of this or a screenshot of this page. We thank you a lot, Dr. Raju, for taking out the time for this talk. Very informative and very interesting session. And thank you, viewers, for joining us this week. Hopefully, we'll see you again next Saturday for Ashish's talk and on Sunday for Sudhir Vyas's talk. Thank you, everyone. Have a good evening.
Let me thank all the participants, and thanks to Delibird and Sanctuary and all the organizers of this for giving me this opportunity. Thank you and namaste. Bye-bye.